And over.
I don't believe it.
I don't care.
1994. It is with a great deal of pride that you have been invited here today to share this special occasion, and we thank you for attending. At this time, I would like to introduce to you our Superintendent of Schools, Mr. David Masinski.
Again, on behalf of all of us at Benzie County Central Schools, we'd like to extend our sincere appreciation and welcome to each of you, and thank you for making this day as special as it is as we honor this graduating class of 1994. This may be the last graduation for many parents of this graduating class, and it may be the first for many parents as we begin honoring our graduates. But I, as always, would like to emphasize a sincere thank you to moms and dads, grandmas and grandpas, brothers and sisters, and friends for the role you have played in your educating and our educating of your son and daughter. For without your help, our job as educators could not have been possible in attaining the degree and the caliber and the quality of the students we're recognizing today. Again, truly thank you, Mom and Dad, for your role in working with your son and daughter throughout the past years and the education that they have all been through. Together, all of us, graduates, parents, family, friends, teachers, Board of Education, and all of us in our community take a great deal of pride in this day in honoring each member of this class of 94. To get to where we are today, it took a lot of help from a lot of people. You, as a graduate, owe a special thank you to many people involved today. If you have that opportunity throughout this day, through open houses, through some special event, and the moment is right, thank that special person who has helped you get to where you are at on this day. Throughout this year, and especially this week at senior night and at baccalaureate, so many positive comments were made about you as a class. These positive comments and activities that we were involved in throughout this week were indicative of the caliber of students that you are. By the way, if you haven't done so, I'd only encourage you to get a hold of that video that we showed the other night. It was very, very special, and some of it may be not so special. But if you haven't, get a copy of that and play that back at your 10th reunion, your 20th reunion, and perhaps your 50th reunion, because it's captured some very special moments that each of you as a class can be very proud of, and that will remind you of what a class you were. Your leadership, your many accomplishments, your sense of community, and your ability to get along with your classmates have gone without or unnoticed and are truly the marks of the success that you are. These positive traits have left students throughout our school system something to look up and model after. Kids in our school system truly want to be like you folks, this graduating class of 1994. When people model after you, that says a lot about the quality and the caliber of students you were, you have been, and you will be. If anything, you, the class of 94, will be remembered as a very special group of young people, young men and women, who have led by your examples, have become role models for all students at Benzie County Central Schools. We encourage each of you to build on all of these successes and on all of your accomplishments. With our congratulations comes our sincere best wishes to each member of this class of 94. Congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. Masinski. This year's speakers at Benzie Central High School for the senior class are the valedictorian and salutatorian. These two students have distinguished themselves through their hard work and dedication toward attaining their goals. It is my pleasure to introduce to you our first student speaker, salutatorian Rachel Fenning.
Good afternoon and welcome family, friends, faculty, and the class of 1994. It is not so easy to leave this cool green garden for a dusty lake. This haiku is very relevant to graduation for a number of reasons. For the past 18 years, we have been shielded by our parents, teachers, and others. We have been contained under this umbrella of protection for our entire lives, always with the secret knowledge of the ever-nearing emergence into the real world. The world which we presumably could not anticipate or comprehend until after our commencement services is suddenly calling us to become part of it, as if we are being handed a season pass with our diplomas. And why today? What makes today so special that we are being invited to the stomping grounds of adults? Do we know how to survive? Have we crammed enough for the real life situations we will encounter? Or perhaps it is just that we are prepared as much as possible and must fend for ourselves with whatever instincts and skills we require. What seems to be forgotten this time of year is that while preparing to make an entrance, we must also prepare to make an exit. We have established relationships throughout the first phase of our lives that will be greatly changed after today. Graduation is a time not only of scholastic recognition, but also a symbolic occasion of coming of age and the necessity to break from the routine. We have struggled to perfect the dynamics of family living, formed many types of friendships, some that will last and some that will provide an understanding of humanity for the future, developed a work ethic for our academic endeavors as well as our extracurricular activities, and not the least of our achievements is a deeper knowledge of ourselves. All of these intangibles will be difficult to recall as our lives change and time distances us from our years together. How long will it be before we forget what classes we like best, or who we shared our first kiss with, or even the last name of our very best friends? To quote R.E.M., it is truly the end of the world as we know it. For me, that may be the most difficult part of entering reality. If leaving is painful, I can imagine how challenging the mythical real world would be. For as long as I can remember, 1994 has been a far-off target, something to wait for, but not actually experience. From our class rings, to the pep assembly cheers, to the identification of our class as a whole, 1994 has become more of a label than a year. But here we sit, on June 5th, 1994, feeling awkward in our uniforms, unsure if we look the part of graduate, uncomfortable with the notion that we are the future. We are filled with ambition and enthusiasm, ready to conquer whatever awaits us. We must not be afraid to accept a challenge or begin things that we think we may be incapable of completing. Each of us should be willing to break out from the pack and take a turn in the lead. To close, I would like to read a poem by Robert Frost, The Tale of the Board Not Taken. Two roads diverged in yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both, and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear, though as for that passing there, had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay, in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how ways lead on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took one less travel by. And that has made all the difference. Thank you.
Our next speaker is our valedictorian. I am pleased to introduce to you at this time, Mary Gehring.
Good afternoon, everyone. In a few minutes, we will receive our diplomas and have done with a momentous graduation. With the receipt of a white piece of paper and a few handshakes, the up till now all-consuming, important high school phase of our life will be over. Afterwards, we'll smile, laugh, some of us might even cry, and perhaps reminisce about the good old days of high school. But while we're all smiling and holding our diplomas up proudly for the camera, the question must be asked, what's next? After we leave here, where do we go? What is to be done after graduation? And no, the answer is not, I'm going to so-and-so's open house, or I'm going to be working at blah, blah, blah this summer. Recently, I heard the president say something that might help us answer these questions. In talking to a group of students, he said, what is important is 5 years from now, not 5 seconds from now. Just because we've received a piece of paper and acknowledgement of our efforts until now, we can't expect to have life made. That type of thinking is unrealistic. The work put into getting this diploma, although important, probably won't show up in our lives in 5 seconds, but more likely in 5 or 10 years. What the president is saying is that we can't expect quick results. I doubt that many of us will leave here today, enter the parking lot, and be greeted by someone who will look at our diploma and offer us an exciting, satisfying job for life. After we've graduated, many of us will relish in the moment. Some of us will feel, erroneously perhaps, that, oh, I've graduated, I'm a full-fledged adult, there's nothing left to do but sit back, cradle my diploma, and watch the pieces of my life fall perfectly into place. Undeniably, we have worked hard to get here, but graduation, although a long 13 years in coming, is only a small first step. It is not the end of hard work, but the beginning. When we were smaller, we couldn't wait to grow up because we knew then that life would be easy. Adults seemingly did nothing, or at least they didn't have to do homework. But now, it's time to realize that although these past few years have been fun, there's a lot to be done after graduation. To get the full value out of our diploma, we must continue to work, whether it be at college or at a job, to better ourselves. As I was preparing to write this speech, I looked for a poem to center it around, or maybe just to be a time filler. I was hoping for one about success, or old friends, or maybe even one entitled graduation. Unfortunately, I had no such luck. I did, however, find one that held an interesting concept, which I would like to read. Written by Priscilla Leonard, it is called Happiness. Happiness is like a crystal, fair and exquisite and clear, broken in a million pieces, shattered, scattered, far and near. Now and then along life's pathway, lo, some shining fragments fall. But there are so many pieces, no one ever finds them all. You may find a bit of beauty or an honest share of wealth, while another just beside you gathers honor, love, or health. Vain to choose or grasp unduly, broken is the perfect ball. And there are so many pieces, no one ever finds them all. Yet the wise is on their journey, treasure every fragment clear, fit them as they may together, imagining the shattered sphere. Learning ever to be thankful, though their share of it is small, for it has so many pieces, no one ever finds them all. I think the image of a shattered ball with pieces flung far and wide to be collected can be applied to many things in life, whether it be happiness or something else. After we leave this graduation, we will each pick up a different piece of life. Treasure yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. At this time, the Benzie Central High School Band, under the direction of Michael Egan, will present America the Beautiful by Carmen Dragan. Thank you, band. Next, our special music will be presented by Mrs. Susan Dean. She will be singing Hero, as sung by Mariah Carey.
Thank you.
Sue.
For the class of 1994, please rise. Mrs. Stapleton, members of the Board of Education, parents, and honored guests, it is my pleasure at this time to present to you the graduating class of 1994. The members of this class have successfully completed all requirements as prescribed by the Benzie Central Board of Education and are now ready to receive their diplomas. We are requesting that the audience refrain from applauding until all graduates have been awarded their diplomas. Please note in your programs those students graduating with honors, high honors, and highest honors. Thank you. Would all at the front row please sit down. Alan Dean Arnold, son of Mrs. Patty Miller and Mr. Terry Arnold. Beverly June Avery, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Irving L. Avery. Robert Atkinson, son of Mr. Robert Atkinson and Debbie Martin. Melissa Yvette Beauchamp, daughter of Robert and Julie Beauchamp. Robert Bent, son of Robert and Chris Bent and June Bent. Deborah E. Bissell, daughter of Ruth and Charles Bissell. Robert Boylan, son of Joanne and Bob Boylan. Patricia K. Bryan, daughter of Mr. Ora and Mrs. Clara Bryan. Jacob Arthur Bright, son of Margaret and Alan Bright. Heather Mary Chatfield, daughter of Mr. Carl Chatfield and the late Mrs. Kristen Collins. Nathan Peter Brower, son of Gary and Bev Brower. Michelle Mariah Cudney, daughter of Wanda Cudney. Kirk Daniel Bruce, son of Mr. and Mrs. Ted Bruce. Melissa Ann Dylas, daughter of Sharon Dylas. Russell Lee Carrier, son of Bert and Paula Carrier. Jennifer Elizabeth Dumbrell, daughter of Richard and Elizabeth Dumbrell. Carl Frederick Eichberger, son of Don and Sally Eichberger. Rochelle R. Egan, daughter of Patrick and Rochelle Egan. Rafael S. Ferrer, son of Mrs. Chris Ferrer and Mr. Joe Ferrer. Jenny Lynn Ely, daughter of Lester and Joyce Ely. Stacy Henry, son of Richard and Noreen Henry. Jessica Joy Gardner, daughter of Greg and Connie Gardner. Daniel Haringa, son of Daniel and Janice Haringa. Margaret Elizabeth Garno, daughter of Mrs. Kelly Garno and Mr. Max Garno. Jason Kyle Hobson, son of Ott and Pat Hobson. Pamela Kathleen Gettings, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Ted Gettings. Scott Johnson, son of Mr. and Mrs. Robert Johnson. Mary Ann Gehring, valedictorian, daughter of John and Christine Gehring. Michael James Jones, son of Daryl and Christine Jones. Jeanette Joy Gunyon, daughter of Mrs. Deborah and Mr. Bob Reed and Mr. Dennis Gunyon. Jason Todd Kelly, son of Tom and Sandy Kelly.
Come on with your man self, Jason!
Heather Ingersoll, daughter of Dan and Vicki Ingersoll. Sean Lardy, son of Mrs. Anna Kirksey and Mr. Joseph Krygalski. Andrea Jewell, daughter of Judy and Rick Jewell. Chad Allen Lathwell, son of Mr. and Mrs. Gary Lathwell and the late Gwendolyn Lathwell. Dawn Marie Johnson, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Carl Johnson and Wanda Leffler. Jeremy Allen Lathwell, son of Mr. and Mrs. Larry Lathwell. Jennifer Lynn Combe, daughter of Gail and Jeff Rail and Jim and Cindy Combe. Scott R. Link, son of Mr. and Mrs. Russell Link. Jennifer J. Lawrence, daughter of Mr. Donald R. Lawrence and Mrs. Diane C. Hauser. Matthew Love, son of Mr. and Mrs. James R. Love. Angela Renee LeCicero, daughter of Mrs. Valerie LeCicero and Mr. Joseph LeCicero. Fred McNinch, son of Tom McNinch and Jeanette McNinch. John Lewis Oakley, son of John and Cindy Oakley. Please be seated. John Lewis Oakley, son of John and Cindy Oakley. Jennifer April Maroy, daughter of Steve and Tony Maroy. Jack M. Papanoff, son of Roger and Carol Papanoff. Jennifer Lynn McKean, daughter of Lori and William McKean. Shane Pavlik, son of Betty and Marty Pavlik. Stephanie Joy McPherson, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Philip R. McPherson. Joshua J. Sayer, son of Ms. Sheila Sayer and Mr. John Sayer. Lindy Sue Meredith, daughter of Craig and Sue Meredith. Matthew D. Sherman, son of Linda and Michael Sherman. Tamara Meisner, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. William Meisner. Ryan Garrett Smith, son of Dennis and Lynn Smith. Harry May Montreal, daughter of Greg and Diane Montreal. Joshua Samuel Stoltz, son of Chris and Bob Bent and Mark Stoltz. Bonnie J. Morton, daughter of Gary and Marcia Morton. Jason Patrick Sullivan, son of Joe and Marilyn Sullivan. Melinda Jean Myers, daughter of Don and Shirley Myers. Justin M. Taylor, son of Mrs. Doris L. Clark and Mr. John C. Taylor. Joelle Andrea Pelkey, daughter of Mr. Jerry Pelkey and the late Judy Pelkey. Joseph Thomas, son of Mr. and Mrs. Calvin Schleter and the late Mr. Hugh Thomas. Rachel Jean Fennick, salutatorian, daughter of Molly and Ray Franks and Harry and Sherry Fennick. Tom Traver, exchange student, son of Mrs. Aneki Traver and Mr. Gerard Traver, living with Mr. and Mrs. Lewandowski. Rebecca Lynn Roberts, daughter of Mrs. Christine Anderson and Mr. James Anderson. Please be seated. Benjamin Roy Westcott, son of Susan and Dale Westcott. Teresa Marie Roll, daughter of Mrs. Patricia Peterson and Tom A. Roll, Sr. Benjamin Joseph Wiggins, son of David and Paulette Wiggins. Christina Janae Ryan, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Michael Ryan. Kevin Wolpoff, son of Mr. Barry Wolpoff and Miss Elizabeth Pertell. Julie Ann Showers, daughter of Mr. Richard Showers and Mrs. Paula Showers. Christy Lynn Schroyer, daughter of Mrs. Pamela Crane and Mr. David Stroyer. Kelly Ann Sneary, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Alan J. Sneary. Rebecca Sue Spaulding, daughter of Philip and Linda Spaulding. Sarah Jo Stevens, daughter of Michael and Kathy Stevens. Jennifer Renee Stott, daughter of Truman and Regina Doyle. Naoko Taniguchi, exchange student, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Taniguchi, living with Ryan and Sue Dean. Mandy Faith Thomas, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Ronald D. Thomas.
All right, Mandy!
Dawn Torreson, daughter of Miss Karen Torreson. Karen Sue Trumbull, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Wayne Trumbull. Paulette Lee Woodward, daughter of Bill and Adrienne Woodward and Bonnie Woodward. Class of 1994, will you again rise? As a sign that you have graduated, would you please join in the tradition of switching your tassel from the right to the left? Congratulations to the parents and the class of 1994. Find your seat. In closing, I would like to tell you a story. It's about a wise man who lived long ago and very far away. This wise man was very kind and loving, and was consequently much beloved by the people of this ancient land. In this same land, there was a nobleman, a prince, who hated this wise man. He saw the wise man as taking from him the love of the people. The people listened to the wise man, not the prince, and that angered the prince beyond belief. One day, the prince said to his followers, "I have a plan whereby I can discredit the wise man, a way in which I can make him appear to be a fool. Each day, the wise man goes to the marketplace where he speaks to the people and gives them advice. Tomorrow, when the people gather, I will go to the square disguised as a peasant. In my hand, I shall hold a white dove. When the crowd has gathered, I shall raise my voice above the crowd and say, 'Wise man, I have a simple question for you. This dove which I hold in my hand, is it alive or dead?' Now, while this appears to be a simple question, it is not. For if he says it is dead, I will open my hand and let the bird fly away. If he says it is alive, however, I will crush the bird in my hand and let it fall dead to the ground. Either way, he will be mistaken. Either way, he will appear to have made a mistake. Either way, it will appear that he cannot even tell the difference between a living and a dead bird. Either way, he will be discredited in the eyes of the people and will lose their love. The next day came, and true to his word, the prince disguised himself as a peasant, and taking a white dove, he went to the marketplace. There he waited until the crowd had gathered and the wise man had appeared. He made his way to the front of the crowd and raised his voice. "Wise man," he shouted, "I would ask you a simple question. This dove which I hold in my hand, is it alive or is it dead?" The crowd grew quiet, and all eyes turned towards the wise man. The wise man paused, looked at the prince, and said, "That which you hold in your hands, it is what you make of it." It is what you make of it. A wise answer from a wise man. Whether the dove which the prince held was alive or dead depended on the prince and what he did with what he had. Today I have told you about a new idea, a new concept, and now I leave it in your hands. What we do with it? Will it be alive to soar and grow and flourish, or will it fall to the ground, dead and unused? In the words of the wise man, it is what we make of it. Congratulations.